Good morning, Christ Church. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let's hear this call to worship from Psalm 73. Whom have I in heaven but you? And there is nothing on earth that I desire besides you. My heart, my flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, give me Jesus. When I am alone, with you. It starts like this. Arise, shine, for your light has come.
Arise, shine.
church, arise and put your armor on.
Oh, church, arise and put your armor on. Hear the call of Christ our captain. For now the weak can say that they are strong in the strength that God has given. With shield of faith and belt of truth, we'll stand against the devil's lies. An army bold, whose battle cry is love, reaching out to those in darkness.
Our call to war is a call to love.
Our call to war, to love the captive soul, but to rage against the captor. And with the sword that makes the wounded whole, we will fight with faith and valor. When faced with trials on every side, we know the outcome is secure, and Christ will have the prize for which he died. Tents of nations.
Sing, arise.
Arise, shine, for your light has come. Arise, shine, for the risen sun. Lift your eyes. Come see the cross where love and mercy meet. As the Son of God is stricken, then see his foes lie crushed beneath his feet. For the conqueror has arisen, and as this stone is rolled away, every eye and heart shall see him.
So Spirit come,
so Spirit come, put strength in every stride, give grace for every hurdle, that we may run with faith to win the prize of a servant good and faithful. As saints of old still line the way, retelling triumphs of his grace. We hear their calls and hunger for the day when with Christ we stand in glory.
Arise.
We are.
Psalm 22, verses 1 through 11 read, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but I find no rest. Yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel, and you our fathers trusted. They trusted and you delivered them. To you they cried and were rescued. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. But I am a worm and not a man, scorned by mankind and despised by the people. All who see me mock me. They make mouths at me. They wag their heads. He trusts in the Lord. Let him deliver him. Let him rescue him, for he delights in him. Yet you are he who took me from the womb. You made me trust you in my mother's breasts. On you I was cast from birth, and from my mother's womb you have been my God. Be not far from me, for trouble is near, and there is none to help. Let's take a moment to put all of our confession, all of our trust, and all of our hope in God. He has been our God from ages past and will continue to be. Let's go to him in confession now. Sinners, the poor and needy, weak and wounded, sick and sore, Jesus ready stands to save you, full of pity, love and power. I will arise and go to Jesus. Arms, and in the arms of my dear Savior, there are 10,000 charms. Come ye thirsty, come ye thirsty, come and welcome God's free bounty, glorify. And ruined by the fall, and if you tarry until you're better, you will never come at all. I will arise, I will arise and go to Jesus. He will embrace me in his arms. Maker lies on the bloody tree behold him, and sinner will this not suffice. Lo incarnate, God ascended, pleads the merit of his blood. Venture on him, venture holy. Let no other trust in you. I will arise. I will arise and go to Jesus. He will embrace me in his arms. And in the arms of my dear Savior, there are 10,000 charms. Hear this assurance of pardon in 1 Peter 1, verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed at the last time. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you've been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with a joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Please pray with me. Father God, we thank you for Jesus Christ. We brought nothing to our salvation except the sin that made it necessary. We brought nothing. And yet God has given us all riches in Christ, so that we treasure Christ above all things. We thank you for our salvation in him. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
How great the chasm. How great the chasm that lay between. By the mountain I could not climb, in desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever.
Given us grace in Jesus Christ because he rose, because he took our sin upon him on the cross. We're going to take a moment to pass the peace that we have with Christ to those sitting near us, and also to those who aren't able to make it here this morning. The peace of Christ be with you.
Well, we're a rowdy bunch this morning. It must be spring. We have some newlyweds in the house this morning. Welcome to Christ Church, Madeline. We had another wedding here yesterday. It was my first ceremony in this building. It was a small affair, but a powerful one. Wasn't it, Danielle? Wasn't it? Kevin and Jen Flowers, but they go by Jen and Kevin. They're honeymooning today. Let's be praying for them, celebrating with them. I'm sure they'll be back next week. Well, it's spring. Finally. Happy spring, Christ Church. Happy Lent. Good to see you today. If you're at home today and still at a distance, we love you, we miss you, we're praying for you, we care about you. God's grace is sufficient for you. If you're listening in this morning at home or wherever you'll listen in today, well, it'll be this afternoon, but anyway, wherever you're listening in, we're praying for you, we're with you. To our Christ Church family, I love this part of our liturgy each week. Thank you for your continued generous giving to this local congregation. God continues to do miraculous things through his ministry here. Let's keep moving forward together. Let's pray and thank God for this day, for Christ Church that we're here, for those in our lives that need to hear the gospel. Let's continue to pray for those in our community that are houseless today, for Brother Harry and the ministry at Sacred Heart. Let's pray for the Lord to continue to add to his church day by day. Amen? Amen. Let's continue to pray for that. Let's pray for this Easter season that's approaching. We'll be celebrating Good Friday service together in person. We'll be celebrating an Easter egg hunt together on a Saturday morning, on Holy Saturday at Creek Ridge County Park together. I can't wait. And we'll be celebrating Easter Sunday together. Let's continue to remember those affected by this pandemic. Let's continue to remember those affected by this pandemic while we pray to a good God who works miracles and continue to believe so. And if there's something just between you and the Lord today, wherever you are, let us offer prayers between just us and God, our God who hears us. Amen. Let's enjoy this time of prayer together, Christ Church. Pray silently and I'll lead us out corporately. Lord, hear our prayers. Father in heaven, holy is your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, from the evil one. Deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. God, we thank you that your church marches on. We thank you for this opportunity today to hear your word. We pray for healing in our lives and the lives of those around us. And we pray today that somebody would come to know Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. I pray for pastors this morning that are preaching your word, that you would strengthen them to proclaim the gospel with boldness as it ought to be proclaimed. We thank you for your presence with us this morning. Holy Spirit, our teacher, our guide, our counselor, open the word to us as you faithfully do. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. If you're at home or wherever you're listening in, grab your Bibles. I'll be reading from the ESV this morning. We're in Luke chapter 6. If you're here in the house, Luke chapter 6, verses 20 to 26. Today we have the Beatitudes and the Woes. A couplet. Another couplet in the Gospel of St. Luke. As we do each week here at Christ Church, let's stand for the reading of God's word. If you're at home Wherever you're listening, please stand with us as well. Verse 20, Luke chapter 6, the Beatitudes. And he, Jesus, lifted up his eyes on his disciples and said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God." Verse 21, "Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you shall be satisfied. Blessed are you who weep now, for you shall laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you and when they exclude you and revile you and spurn your name as evil on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day," Jesus said, "and leap for joy, for behold, your reward is great in heaven, for so their fathers did to the prophets." Verse 24, Jesus pronounces woes. "But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full now, for you shall be hungry. Woe to you who laugh now, for you shall mourn and weep. Woe to you when all people speak well of you, for so their fathers did to the false prophets." This is the word of God. Thanks be to God. Whew, Luke. Let me define the word woe for us this morning as we move into our text. Simple definition of woe is grief, regret, or distress. But in this text and in Luke's gospel, there is grace and peace and not judgment. I pray you're noticing these couplets in Luke, these, as you're studying it together, as you're reading it at home, as you're reading it in a small group, in your family, on your own. Hi, Joy. Hi, Joy. As you're enjoying the gospel on your own, in the gospel of Luke, there are couplets, meaning a point and a point, a thought and a thought. There's rhythm, there's tempo throughout the gospel. You pick up on it when you read it aloud. I encourage you to do so. Read the gospel of Luke aloud. These are literary devices that are used by Luke, inspired by the Holy Spirit, to highlight pairs of thought or comparisons of two different or similar things, literally, as you get into Luke. I encourage you to do so. So I have an illustration, a story, if you will. It includes Hannah. So her daddy's a crier. Any criers in the house? Anybody cry? Oh, of course. Oh, Carol's already crying. I was already crying this morning when I woke up with Zoe, Carol, anyway. Daddy's a crier. Oftentimes, it's in a movie with Hannah or Melissa. And they can tell when it's a part where I'm about to cry. And before I do so, they'll look over at me and chuckle. And then there's some comment, "Daddy's crying again. Why is he crying?" I mean, I've been that way my whole life, but it's fine. This last week, it was, I'm gonna actually name the movie. It was Hotel Transylvania 3. Oh, I know, there's a third one. And it was Hannah during the movie, and I don't even, we were just enjoying a movie together, Hannah and I. I think Melissa was reading a book at the time. We were all on the sectional. And Hannah, some moment of love happened, and Hannah just leaned over and kissed me on the cheek. Well, I was destroyed at that point. That had nothing to do with the movie, did it? She just leaned over and she said, she just leaned over. Well, she was here. She leaned over, she went, "Love you, Daddy." Whoo. Man. Well, I cried then. In my notes, I said, she snuck in and kissed me on the cheek. And what I felt in that moment was meek, tender, and strong. From a 9-year-old. Meek, tender, and strong. I felt love, I felt humility, and I started asking myself, and I'm going to ask us today, think of a story or a time in your life where you've felt humble, where you've been humbled, where you were humble, or a time in your marriage or your family, wherever you're at today listening to this, when you had, I love this part, where you had hardly anything and they were the happiest days of your life, right? The happiest days of your life. when you had hardly anything. I'm thinking on this point of so many stories I've heard of newlyweds who are like, oh, those were just beautiful days where we had hardly anything, but we just had each other, right? And that's all that mattered. Or a season when you went through something hard and God's presence became the only thing you could cling to. And that's what you actually needed. Or a time in your life when God's word came alive to you. This is what it's all about. And we're in the scriptures this morning in the Gospel of Luke. And so we'll come back to the text, to two groups of truth, two responses to Jesus and his teaching, and two groups of people. Verse 20, the Beatitudes, the blessing. There's a movie where somebody does it. I'm obviously on this morning. There's a movie where the phrase the blessing is used, but it's said this way, the blessing. Anybody know that movie? No? Christmas Vacation. In the Beatitudes, another way of saying that would just be blessing. Jesus' disciples and followers have been following this amazing and powerful teacher. But they thought they were following someone that was ready to overthrow kings and kingdoms physically. These were Jesus' hand-picked disciples in this gospel. They were the cream of the crop to him. And I think as we live into this story of the disciples, we might think that these are the people that had everything going right for them. They had everything together. Maybe they had outward beauty. Maybe they had an amazing Instagram account or a Facebook profile. Maybe they were the strongest or the biggest or the elite. No, they weren't. They were the poor. This is who Jesus was teaching to. They were the poor and the hungry. They were the weeping ones. They were the hated. They were the excluded. They were the spurned. And they were the reviled. And in the text, Jesus said, blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. This is back in verse 20. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you shall be satisfied. Hear the tempo in this text. Blessed are you who weep now, for you shall laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you and when they exclude you and when they revile you and when you're spurned for the revile you and spurn your name as evil on the account of me, on the account of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day. Leap for joy when you're hated and poor and spurned and reviled. For behold, your reward is great, not on earth, but in heaven. For so their fathers did to the prophets, those given the voice of God. I was listening to a really good teaching this week. I think it was this last Sunday, but I listened to it over. Actually, it was on the way to your guys' wedding. I was listening to this teaching. And this preacher said, soon it's not going to be cool to talk about Jesus being the way. Soon it's not going to be cool to talk about Jesus, possibly at all. I'm not being prophetic this morning. I'm quoting a good preacher who said, soon it might not be cool to talk about Jesus. Soon it might not be cool to say Jesus is the way of salvation. Are you ready for that, Christ Church, in that day when we say Jesus is the way and it's just not cool? And it offends, and it hurts. Because to me, and I know to us in this room today, Jesus is the way, isn't he? Amen? His word is the way. His teaching is the way. His way is the way. He's the way. He's the truth, and he's the life. And I need him every day. I need his word. I need his teaching. And I need to come to him like I'm poor and I'm hungry, like a crier. That's too fun. What this preacher continued on is what we've experienced as a society, as a church, as a people. We've experienced a purification of our mission. That's why people are getting married right now. That's why babies are being born. That's why it's wedding season right now. This is literal growth in the gospel. And what we are experiencing has been a recentering on what really matters. Amen? We will face opposition, Christ Church, for being about this reality. This is the point of my message today. Just Jesus. Just Jesus. It's the point of Luke's message. It's the point of the scriptures. And Jesus' teaching, opposition may in fact come from our religious establishments. That's what we see in the Gospel of Luke. It may come from within the church because we're not going with the flow. A wise pastor told me that this week as well. And on these points, rejoice, leap for joy. Your reward is in heaven, Jesus says. So their fathers did to the prophets, the voice of God. What an opportunity to examine our own hearts today, Christ Church, our own motivations, our own holding on to things that have always been, our own positions of power, our own desires for comfort and stability, our culture, our politics, etc. I said that. Jesus' Sermon on the Mount in Matthew. You can turn to Matthew chapter 6, verses 1 through 4. It'll appear on the screen. Beware of practicing your righteousness before other people in order to be seen. And here we're going to move into the woes briefly. Beware of practicing your righteousness before other people in order to be seen by them. For then you will have no reward from your Father who is in heaven. Thus, when you give to the needy, sound no trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do. This is verse 2 of Matthew chapter 6. As the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may be praised by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. Verse 3, but when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret. And we're back to the beginning of this text. Your Father who sees in secret that you are poor, that you are hungry, that you weep when you weep, that you feel excluded, that you are reviled, that you are spurned on account of Jesus, that you rejoice. Your Father who sees this in secret will reward you. These are the spiritual practices of Lent. Giving, fasting, prayer, laying up treasures in heaven, not worrying about tomorrow. If you would continue in that text in Matthew chapter 6, I encourage you to do so. Jesus' Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 5, 6, and 7 is phenomenal, of course. I encourage you to look at that this week. And we come to the woes of Luke 6 through 11. The woed ones, I wrote, the false prophets, those who reject Jesus and his word, the hurting, the distressed, the regrettable, the rich. It's not bad to have money. But we cannot love God and mammon. The full, the laughers, the haughty, the scoffers, the proud. Those spoken well of, those who please people and not God. For so their fathers did to the false voices of their day. And on those matters, and that I think that reality is in all of our hearts, all we need is repentance and faith, and both are gifts from God. Psalm 1 says, we know it, don't sit in the seat of scoffers. Don't listen to that voice. Listen to the word of God. Meditate on the law of the Lord day and night. Be like a tree. And in fact, at that point, you'll be like a tree planted by rivers of living water. You'll yield your fruit in season, and you will not wither. Meditate on the law of the Lord. And so let's remind ourselves today of Luke's theme. When Jesus returned to his hometown in the synagogue that he grew up in, and he grabbed the scroll and went to Isaiah, the prophet, and said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor," and not to proclaim judgment, to proclaim favor. And then Jesus rolled up the scroll and gave it back to the attendant and sat down. Salvation for all, for the nations. How will we continue to grow in this reality? And now we come today to the bridge. We come to the bridge. What is my main point? I was working on this one this week. I think we're getting a message from this. This one was a tough one to just have a main point on, okay? But here's what God was working on in me, and I pray he works on in us. Humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, and in due time he will exalt you, the scripture says. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Humble yourself. Don't try to humble others. Be about the singularity of Jesus and submission to his teaching, no matter the cost. And there is a voice in this message, and it is not the message of this world. It is alien, it is other, it is stranger, it is stronger. Amen, isn't it? Amen. Amen. The gospel. Jesus is the only voice we need. Will we listen, obey, and follow like the 12 disciples, apostles? Or will we live in woe? Will we choose woe? Here's a mild little tangent. Woe sometimes feels safe. Regret feels safe. Distressed feels safe. Being rich feels safe. Laughing, haughty, scoffing, proud. Being spoken well of feels safe. But it kills us. And on that point, Jesus laid down his life. I love it, I wrote this. And then he gave us an imaginary friend, the ghost, the Holy Spirit, not an imaginary friend. Now we're back to a Disney movie. Well, I think we started with Hotel Transylvania 3, right? Jesus laid down his life and gave us a companion, a counselor, an advocate. And so we come to the Lord's table today. We've heard the gospel that we are forgiven. And this message is for us, it's for me, it's for you in the room, it's for wherever you are listening today. But I feel like this message is also for so many that are in our lives, so many that we come across every single day that are in woe, that need Jesus. We're coming to the Easter season. We invite somebody to Christ Church. Invite somebody into your home. Invite somebody to join you in your small group. Invite someone to come and be around the teachings of Jesus. Amen? So many need to hear this message. I need to hear it today. So do us. Thanks be to God. Wherever you are, you prepare your communion elements. Now we come to the Lord's table. If you're at home, I pray that you begin to enjoy this meal with us today. If you're listening in later in the week, pray that you enjoy this meal. This meal is for all of God's family. If you believe Jesus has saved you, this meal is for you. If you feel him saving you in this moment, this meal's for you. If you want to begin a journey with him today, or if you want to know more about him, we would be honored if you reach out to us. We'd love to hear from you today. Here at Christ Church, we celebrate communion by dipping the bread in the cup. We invite you here in the house, wherever you are, to prepare your communion elements as we receive this meal together. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you for the sufficiency of your grace in our lives. We thank you for the voice of the scriptures. I pray that we as a people would be about the word of God. May it continue to transform us. And today we come back to the Lord's table, to the body broken for us, to the blood shed for us, for our salvation. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. Take the bread. The body of Christ broken for you. You can dip it in the cup. The blood of Christ shed for you. Thanks be to God, Christ Church.
Worthy of every song. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Oh, we live for you. We sing holy. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Oh, we live for you. We sing holy.
I will put my trust in you.
As we leave today, I want to send you with this benediction. I want to invite you to extend a hand as to receive from the Lord today. This comes from Numbers 6. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Let us bless the Lord. Go in peace, Christ Church.